has ever been known to us. No deeper grace could ever be shown to us. God, our Creator, sent us His suffered and died, laid down His life, wonderful love, no greater. Thank you.
Welcome to our worship this morning. It's great to have you with us. I'm Derek Simpson, the rector of Thirsk Parishes. And during the service, it's a fantastic encouragement. If you can share, let us know that you're there, but also any responses, any echoes of amen or prayers that you'd like for us all to share in. It just encourages to, as we know one another, as we're gathered together. If you've a candle, we're going to light it in a moment. As we begin, we've got a couple of responses that will appear on the screen as we light this candle. And this morning we're going to be thinking about the centrality of prayer for the Christian life, the heartbeat and the reality of our relationship with our Heavenly Father. So, let's begin. We come from scattered lives to meet with God. Let us recognise his presence with us. As God's people, we have gathered. Let us worship him together. So a prayer as we begin. Let your merciful ears, O Lord, be open to the prayers of your humble servants. And so that they may obtain their petitions, make them to ask such things as shall please you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. In a moment, Anita's going to bring us our Bible reading from Isaiah 56. And it's about being welcome in God's house, in the temple. I just want you to think, before she brings that reading, just for a moment, what's the difference between feeling at home or just visiting? Anita.
Today's reading is taken from Isaiah chapter 56, verses 1 to 8. Salvation for others. This is what the Lord says. Maintain justice and do what is right, for my salvation is close at hand, and my righteousness will soon be revealed. Blessed is the one who does this, the person who holds it fast, who keeps the Sabbath without desecrating it, and keeps their hands from doing any evil. Let no foreigner who is bound from the Lord to say, the Lord will surely exclude me from his people, and let no eunuch complain, I am only a dry tree. For this is what the Lord says, to the eunuchs who keep my Sabbath, who choose what pleases me, and hold fast to my covenant, to them I will give within my temple and its walls a memorial and a name. Better than sons and daughters, I will give them an everlasting name that will endure forever. And foreigners who bind themselves to the Lord, to minister to him, to love the name of the Lord, and be his servants, all who keep the Sabbath without desecrating it, and who hold fast to my covenant, these I will bring to my holy mountain and give them joy in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and sacrifices will be accepted on my altar. For my house will be called a house of prayer for all nations. The Sovereign Lord declares, he who gathers the exiles of Israel, I will gather still others to them, besides those already gathered. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Anita. So the question is, does the reality live up to the dream? It's hard when reality seems not to match up, when the holiday brochure doesn't live up to the reality, or when the mirror reveals a different truth, or when the best laid plans don't quite come off. Here, Isaiah is speaking to the people of Israel in exile as part of a long reflection on how God's people live God's way when nature or realpolitik or leadership or their own circumstances seems to make it unrealistic. Isn't that just an ideal he's setting before people? The kingdom can seem like an ideal when Jesus says, love your enemy, forgive others, turn the other cheek, or live by the spirit of God's law. In verse 1, Isaiah encourages the people of God to live by the rules of the kingdom of God, even in a foreign land. He says in verse 1, maintain justice, do what is right, for soon my salvation will come and my deliverance will be revealed. We are called to bring the future reality into the present experience. He's saying, see the vision and live by it now. God encourages his people to live now by the vision of the future, to live by the kingdom's rules, even when everyone else around them is living by a different ethic. So how are they to do that? How are we to do that? Well, first of all, let's get our vision, our dream, which is actually the reality, clearer in our sights. So Isaiah gives them a picture of God's temple, of a united people gathered from every nation, welcomed into God's home, a place where their brokenness is healed, their sinfulness forgiven, a place of Sabbath welcome and wholeness, full of joy and praise and celebration. Listen to verse 7. These I will bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. I wonder whether that phrase, a house of prayer for all peoples, begins to spark a connection. Do you remember as Jesus was walking with his disciples, he talked about the great temple of stone. Of course, here for Isaiah's initial readers, there was a sense of a future picture for the exiled people of Israel. We live in the real now, but look for the glorious vision that is to come. And so when we hear Jesus echoing that phrase, he says, destroy this temple and in 3 days I will raise it up. He's referring to the great stone temple as Hebrews does, as simply a picture of the real meeting place between God and man. He was speaking of himself as the temple, the place to meet with God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. He is the living temple, and Jesus is making God's invitation to us all to taste the future as we draw close to him. And we have seen Jesus inaugurate the future. He has defeated the futility of sin and the finality of death. For the Christian, the Father invites us, come on in, draw near, relax and rest. Let me help you turn our vision together into reality in your life, in the community where you live and stay, and in the world which was and is and will always be mine. So come on in is God's invitation. A radical inclusivity, all peoples, all nations, and a welcome assurance that we are forgiven. Our sacrifice is in Christ. What Christ has done means that we are forgiven and set free and accepted. So that relationship, which we call prayer, is at the heart of the Christian life. It's not an additional spiritual practice or a discipline that we must engage in. It is the very breath of our life in Christ. So how do we live by that vision in the reality of our time pressures, of those things that hold us back? Why do we find that maintaining that relationship with God through prayer so challenging? Well, I want us just in a moment or two to spend a bit of time reflecting. There's going to be music playing in the background as I invite you to reflect with me using some of the verses from this passage of Isaiah 56. I want you to first of all reflect on what holds you back and then hear the words of assurance and invitation echoed through those centuries to remind us that this relationship is living and glorious, and it is not a duty but a joy at all times and in all places to give him thanks and praise. So let's be still. You may want to just sit holding your hands open, both to let go of those things that prevent us from spending that intimate time with him, and also to receive from him. So here and still, what are the barriers that we encounter to our relationship with God? Maybe there is sometimes a sense of exclusion or fear or unworthiness. Listen to the radical inclusivity of God's invitation. You are welcome. Verse 3, do not let the foreigner join to the Lord. Say, the Lord will surely separate me from his people. And do not let the eunuch say, I am just a dry tree. You're not just a dry tree. You're not here on sufferance. But the Father welcomes you. God the Father wants you here and in his presence. Maybe one of the other challenges is our sin. But of course, of Christians, we know that Jesus Christ has made the ultimate sacrifice and our sin is removed. We are clothed in righteousness. Here in verse 7, in God's home, we are welcomed and accepted. Verse 7, their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar. God the Father has made you clean. Fear not. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Receive his forgiveness and his peace. And sometimes there's that dread of prayer as work or labour. But we all know, don't we, that work is not work that we enjoy or that is fulfilling and satisfies us. God will satisfy us. And his vision is of our relationship with him, yes, doing real work, but work that is fulfilling and purposeful and full of joy. Here again, the second part of verse 7. These I will bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. So relax. And when you come into his presence, begin with joy. Heavenly Father, thank you that we are welcome, and all of us are welcome. Thank you that we are free and healed through what Christ has done. And thank you that you long for us to know the joy of living always and at all times in your presence. And now, as we continue in prayer, Bob will lead us in our intercessions for God's world.
Sisters and brothers in Christ, God invites us to hold our needs of our friends and loved ones before him. And so, loving our neighbours as ourselves, we offer our thanksgiving and petitions on behalf of the Church and the whole world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Faithful God, we pray today, O Lord, for our blessing to be on this congregation, upon this church, and upon our homes, and for your presence to be taken, seen vividly in what we do and say each day. We pray that the joy of our love will flow freely and through us, and that we might never be a temptation to those around us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Creator God, we pray for all in the community, that they may be tempted to abuse or misuse their power. We continue to pray for the persecuted Christian believers and for the minority Christian communities where they are under pressure, and for all who suffer for their faith. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Father God, we pray for the times when our blinking vision prevents us from taking care of our immediate family and household, or when through our busyness we take no part in the life of the neighbourhood or the wider community. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, friend of those in need, your Son Jesus Christ can free us from our burdens and heal our body and spirits. We pray for those still burdened and those seeking healing, those in need with the Church and the Word. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray too for those suffering from addiction and any kind of, we ask you to help them to put the temptation of Satan and the world behind them. And we also continue to pray for those affected by the pandemic in any way, especially those who will not recover. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful God, we commend into your hands all who have departed in this life. You gave them breath and loved them through the journey of life. Receive them now at the end of their journey into your eternal presence, so that they may rest in everlasting peace. We pray particularly for all the people in Beirut and other parts of the world where there is conflict. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, as we go out into the world, we pray that you may reflect your love in our families, our church, and our community, so that the world can witness that we are followers of Christ and draw others into his loving care. Merciful Father, accept these, the prayers, for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Bob. And we join together the family prayer, united in God's house, gathered through the living temple of Christ, in the prayer that he taught us, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We're going to sing our final hymn together. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow.
At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. Every tongue confess him, King of glory now. 'Tis the Father's pleasure, we should call him Lord, who from the beginning was the mighty Word. Humbled for a season, to receive a name from the lips of sinners unto whom he came. Faithfully he bore it, spotless to the last, brought it back victorious from when death he passed. Christians name him with love strong as death, but with awe and wonder and with bated breath. He is God the Saviour, he is Christ the Lord, ever to be worshipped, trusted and Jesus shall return again with his Father's glory, with his angel train. For all reigns of empire meet upon his brow, and our hearts confess him King of glory.
And Jill's going to bring us some notices and news of what's happening across the benefice.
So here are the notices. You can now worship either online or in person at St Mary's. Both services are at 10:15. We are one church community worshipping in two different places. If you should go to St Mary's, please do wear a face covering unless you're exempt. And observe all the social distancing and the hand sanitising and those sorts of things, please. If you wish to worship online, you can do that via Facebook page. Also tonight we have the Six, which is an online service again, you can find on the Facebook. The prayer meeting's coming up. Do please come along to that if you can. Everything we do is rooted in prayer and we really do need you there. And it's a huge encouragement to the leadership team. The more people that come, we really do feel supported. So do please come and join us with praying about these different things that are coming up. Although we have the pandemic, that hasn't stopped God, obviously, and hopefully it's not stopping us. So we have a lot of things that we have in mind, but we do need to pray about it. So join us if you can. Small groups are a lovely way of gathering together, sharing fellowship and learning together. If you'd like to be in a small group, speak to somebody and we can help you with that. There's a summer social on Wednesday, just a fun evening, getting together, being with some of the other people in the small groups, but also in the church community. So everybody's welcome to come along and join in that. Just to let you know, we have been using some money to send crafts each week to our lovely after-school club explorers. We obviously can't meet in person, but we've been doing this since lockdown on Zoom every week. And that's a response really to one of the mums getting in touch saying how much her child was really missing their friends and the social interaction. This picture was taken, we were looking at Samuel. and how he was listening to God's call. So the craft was to make a big pair of ears out of a paper plate and a pipe cleaner. They're just a great group, and we're getting to know them really well and having some really good conversations. We're also responding to some parents who have let us know that some of their young children are asking a lot of searching questions about death. So we are looking at putting together a Zoom meeting for parents, possibly looking at this resource put together by Messy Church, just to enable parents to have those conversations with their children about death and the Christian hope, and just really supporting them during this pandemic and the questions that children are asking. So that's just to let you know about that coming up, and we will be advertising that later. And finally, do stay in touch. It's so important during this time. Contact details for all of us are on the website. Please get in touch. Do read the church newsletter that comes out every week, because that is full of information as well. Thank you. I think that's it for now.
Thank you, Jill. And so we draw our worship to a close as we invite God's blessing, and as we go to walk with him, living the reality of the kingdom through the power of our relationship with him in the Spirit. The Spirit of truth lead you into all truth, give you grace to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, and strengthen you to proclaim the word and works of God. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you, remain with you always. Amen. So whether we worship online or in person, we are united in God's meeting place through Christ. We'll be meeting again next Sunday at 10:15 on the website or Facebook, and also this evening at 6 o'clock online, and in person next week at 10:15. Do join us for coffee after this service. It's great to meet up and chat. Everyone is welcome to come along to that, and the details are on the screen. Keep in touch with us and with one another. Check out the website, thirstparishes.org, or our Facebook page, facebook.com/thirstparishes. And God be with you. Amen. Sacrifice offered in place of us.
Thank you. Say he is Lord. Jesus. One